Alors bonsoir, Yokoso, bienvenue à la Grande Bibliothèque et permettez-moi de me présenter. Je suis Nicole Vallière, la directrice de la programmation culturelle à la Bibliothèque et Archives nationales du Québec. Ce soir, nous avons l'immense plaisir d'accueillir une grande figure du paysage culturel japonais, mangaka, romancier, critique et professeur à l'Université de design de Kobe. Professeur Otsuka réexaminera les origines esthétiques de l'animé et du manga, ainsi que les origines de la culture otaku. Présenté dans la foulée de notre entente de partenariat avec l'Université Concordia et dans le cadre de l'année manga à la Grande Bibliothèque, cette conférence ouvre le cycle de conférences du recteur de l'Université Concordia, Experiencing the Media Mix, Anime, Manga, Video Games, qui se penche sur l'impact commercial et culturel de la convergence des médias au Japon. Avant de céder la parole à M. Graham Carr, vice-recteur intérimaire recherche et études supérieures et doyen des études supérieures à l'Université Concordia, je vous rappelle que cette activité fait l'objet d'une captation audiovisuelle et que la traduction anglaise des échanges sera disponible sur le portail de l'Université Concordia dans les jours qui suivent. Il est par ailleurs interdit de prendre des photographies, d'enregistrer la lecture et je vous remercie d'éteindre vos téléphones cellulaires. Alors, à titre d'information, venez prendre note que les canaux 2 est pour la langue anglaise, le canot 4 pour le français et le 6 pour le japonais. Alors, je vous souhaite une très belle soirée. Monsieur Carr.
Merci à Nicole de votre chaleureuse accueil. Nous nous avons reçus pour une deuxième année consécutive ici à la Grande Bibliothèque. Ladies and gentlemen, it's truly an honor for us to be here today and to be able to welcome Professor Otsuka to Montreal, to the Bibliothèque et Archives nationales du Québec and to Concordia University. This lecture kicks off the fifth edition of the President's Conference Series, in which our guests and Concordia experts will probe the effervescent Japanese media mix of manga, anime, and gaming that has proven so captivating to generations of fans around the world. La conférence de ce soir s'inscrit dans le partenariat quinquennial conclué l'Université Concordia et Bibliothèque et Archives nationales du Québec. Elle offre un excellent complément à l'exposition Manga, l'art du mouvement, qui tiendra l'affiche à la Grande Bibliothèque jusqu'à la fin du mois de septembre. Par ailleurs, dans le cadre du colloque qui aura lieu demain au cinéma J.A. de Sèvres, des spécialistes de Concordia et d'autres universités discuteront recherche, création et enseignement dans le contexte des mangas, des animés et des jeux vidéo et dans la sphère des médias japonais. Ils s'intéresseront également à l'impact que ces créations ludiques exercent autour du monde dans une myriade de langues et de cultures. Je dois ajouter que je suis très reconnaissant à vous, Madame Vallière, et toute votre équipe pour votre soutien à cette série conférence. Notre partenariat avec BANQ et ce programme merveilleusement varié de conférences, spectacles et discussions nous a fourni des occasions exceptionnelles de présenter les capacités de recherche et recherche-création de l'Université Concordia. Japanese animation is renowned worldwide for its distinctive style as an art form and its treatment of a wide variety of content from the modern and the mundane to epic tales of adventure and dramatic chronicles of historical figures. And of course, it's all thriving at Concordia too. It flourishes through things such as student-run organizations that showcase anime and through our scholars who help us to understand the dynamics of the complex Japanese media mix. At Concordia, our approach is interdisciplinary. Concordia's research center, Technoculture, Art, and Games, playfully known by its acronym TAG, is such an example. TAG brings together scholars, artists, designers, engineers, and students from across faculties and disciplines who are interested in game studies and design, digital culture, and interactive art. In addition to being a catalyst for research and creation, TAG builds bridges to game developers and international researchers and artists. TAG is also affiliated with the Hexagram Institute, which is the largest arts and design-based new media lab in Canada. More than 80 researchers and 400 graduate students use Hexagram resources in their research projects. At Concordia's Mel Hoppenheim School of Cinema, where students can learn the full process of film animation, they are encouraged to develop their own creativity while exploring the technical and conceptual aspects of this art form. This creativity has been recognized by peers locally, nationally, and internationally. Faculty, students, and alumni from the film animation program have won hundreds of international awards, including 8 nominations for an Oscar, and can boast 1 Academy Award win so far. These are just some of the ways in which Concordia is interconnected with the world of gaming and animation. Now, I want to take care of just a little bit of housekeeping before we start. As Nicole has already indicated, this event is being videotaped and will be uploaded to Concordia's iTunes U account in the next few days. And in the interest of reaching the broader community of people interested in our keynote speaker, Professor Otsuka, we will also be live tweeting. And if you're inclined, please join the conversation on Twitter by using the hashtag CUPCS. Veuillez utiliser l'hashtag CUPCS. And now it's my pleasure to invite 2 Concordia professors who have been instrumental in putting this event together and in attracting our keynote speaker. Mark Steinberg is a Concordia Assistant Professor of Film Studies in the Mel Hoppenheim School of Cinema. After acquiring an interest in Japanese media culture while completing his undergraduate studies in East Asian studies, Mark began to study famous Japanese artists who draw on the aesthetics of manga and anime. His research challenges us to rethink the media experience. And my colleague, Concordia History Professor Matthew Penny, has lived, studied, and traveled widely in Japan, and is a specialist internationally known for his work on Japanese history, and particularly memory, popular culture, and the legacies of World War II. At tomorrow's symposium, he will provide insights about manga adaptations of history texts. Veuillez accueillir Marc et Matthew.
C'est un peu de tag team. Mesdames et messieurs, bonsoir. C'est un vrai plaisir pour moi de vous souhaiter la bienvenue et de vous présenter une courte introduction à Monsieur Otsuka. It is my great honor to welcome Professor Otsuka Eiji to Montreal to give the keynote lecture of this conference, Experiencing the Media Mix. The media mix is the Japanese term for the strategy of promoting transmedia synergy, the movement of works across media forms, from films to video games, comic books to amusement rides, novels to soundtracks. One of the reasons it is particularly exciting to welcome Professor Otsuka here today is because he was one of the masterminds behind its current form. As an employee at Kadokawa Books in the late 1980s, he worked closely with its current CEO, Kadokawa Tsuguhiko, to develop what would become the model for the media mix for the next 2 decades. There, he also developed what was arguably the first media mix based around a world rather than a given product, which is the Madara series of comics, novels, role-playing games, and video games. This is the very same company that went on to produce the most important media mixes of the 1990s and 2000s, Neon Genesis Evangelion, Suzumiya Haruhi Lucky Star, to name just a few, which of course are known as comics, animation, video games, and a lot of other things as well. It is fair to say that Professor Otsuka's work at Kadokawa is one of the main reasons for the commercial successes of these groundbreaking works. But what makes Professor Otsuka such an important figure is not only his key role in the development of the current model of the media mix, it is also that in the late 1980s, he was publishing a series of essays describing his work in theoretical terms that were published in a number of important journals of the time. A Theory of Narrative Consumption, the book that these journals were collected as, published in 1989, became the industry manual of the Kadokawa media mix practice and was read by advertising executives across Japan. Moreover, since then, Professor Otsuka has gone on to publish groundbreaking academic and popular books on an astonishingly wide range of subjects that include manga aesthetics, the cultural ethnography of the young girl or shoujo, analyses of fan or otaku modes of consumption, and several tomes that boldly rewrite the history of Japanese literature from the perspective of subcultures. In recent years, he has published books on Japanese animation and comics that examine the often overlooked wartime years as a key moment of the development of the post-war Japanese visual culture. Indeed, this will be the subject of his talk today. Professor Otsuka has also continued to write novels and the scripts for comics. He is a public intellectual, cultural producer, and media historian who bridges academia and the public sphere, critical thinking, and cultural production in a way that is both remarkable and refreshing. In short, he is a rare figure who, hands down, in my opinion, is the most interesting writer in Japan today. In short, I might also add that Professor Otsuka only rarely travels abroad to give public lectures, so we are particularly thrilled to welcome him here today. For all these reasons and more, it is a true honor to welcome Professor Otsuka to Montreal. And here I pass the floor to my colleague, Matthew Penny. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is my great pleasure to welcome our guest, Professor Eiji Otsuka, to Montreal. Professor Otsuka is not only a leading critic of Japanese animation, manga, and related media, he's also a respected and dynamic creator. Professor Otsuka is most famous in the English and French-speaking worlds for scripting the popular manga graphic novels, MPD Psycho and the Kurosagi Corpse Delivery Service, but these are only a small part of his prolific output. Professor Otsuka has identified strategies in cross-media marketing, which allowed companies such as media giant Kadokawa to build their brands in an increasingly diverse and cutthroat consumer environment. He has also worked as an editor on diverse projects. As a creator, however, Professor Otsuka has gone outside the norms of the mainstream as a fascinating iconoclast and a critic of the Japanese state. Much of Professor Otsuka's work pushes the boundaries of manga and related media. The MPD in MPD Psycho is short for Multiple Personality Disorder. The series features a split personality detective and breaks up the search for clues and the questioning of suspects between different personas. Outraged by the American invasion of Iraq and the Japanese government's commitment of non-combat support in 2003, Professor Otsuka used one of the protagonist's splintered selves to deliver an impassioned anti-war appeal. Professor Otsuka has balanced his pop culture products with activist projects. For example, he encouraged middle and high school students from across Japan to write their own versions of the preamble to the Japanese Constitution and published a collection of these stressing pacifism and human rights. Japan is often criticized for the gap between its official pacifism and the hesitance of many to look honestly at the past war crimes of the Japanese military. Professor Otsuka has tackled this problem head on. In his manga about ghosts and spirits, he has resurrected victims and perpetrators of the Rape of Nanking, atrocities carried out against Chinese civilians by the Japanese troops in 1937, and still denied by some on Japan's far right, bringing past war crimes into focus for contemporary manga readers. Professor Otsuka has also tackled many of Japan's other hot-button issues, such as censorship, corruption, discrimination, insider trading, domestic violence, and organized crime. His work can be challenging and even uncomfortable, but daring decisions like these have won Otsuka a devoted following in his home country and among fans of graphic storytelling internationally. Published in English by Dark Horse and in French by Pika, Professor Otsuka is one of the most dynamic creators of Japanese popular culture working today. It's our great pleasure to welcome him to Montreal. I now turn the floor over to Professor Otsuka.
Thank you very much for this introduction that I received. Eiji Otsuka is my name. Today, I'm in Montreal, and I'd be glad to speak about manga and animated art. This provides, and I'm in a little bit of a dilemma. I'm in a little bit of a dilemma because at this point, I'm 53 years of age. I was born in 1958. And in Japan, we're in the generation, part of the generation, the otaku generation, which otaku, when I was 20, when I heard that word, I was involved in a column. And the column I used, otaku was what we called about the... now, otaku in Japan, it refers a little bit, a social title. It's a negative connotation today. In reality, in terms of the political opinions or political ideas, we were not involved. We were not involved at a young age in political ideas, and we tried to avoid political involvement, and we tried to go through a culture a little bit hermetic towards the outside world. We were antisocial, if you want, at that age. And maybe that's the way it should have been. If there were our expression, we never thought about that our culture would go beyond Japanese borders, for example, to Canada or to elsewhere. That in general we would outreach. So when we talk about manga and animated art. It's unexpected. We didn't expect to get the attention. It's become an international theme. It's gained, and as of tomorrow, in the symposium tomorrow, in the different presentations we'll be hearing about, we'll be talking about otaku, and will be one of the themes. This might appear bizarre as a phenomenon, but today what I want to talk to you about is the. I might not be speaking to what you're expecting to hear, because when we talk about animated art in Japan, there are two ways to look at animated art. First of all, in the library, there's an exhibit going on. Is a kiyoe the exhibit? And there's various collections, which you will see, which are on exhibit, some of my older collections, and some of the rural drawings, some of the earlier drawings, which you'll be able to see the references in the exhibit. This type of explaining animated art, as we talk about manga and animated art, but with postmodernism in industrial countries, we're all going through this, and when we try to associate postmodernism with animated art or with manga, in Japan, this is being done in Japan, but that's not my intention. That's not what I'm going to talk about. I'm not going to talk about this association with postmodernism. I won't. This is not particularly what I intend to focus on. And because I don't think it's relevant to talk about manga and my relationship to modernism, what I'm going to think about is the origins, where it comes from, where manga started, when we talk about where it originated. It goes back to the Second World War in Japan. In the 1940s, in Japan, we had a 15-year war. We called it the 15-year war. For the Second World War for us was a 15-year-old war because we first began fighting against China and its allied countries, or we worked against. So we talked about a 15-year-old war. Began with the war against China, then the war against the Allies. It was a long state of war. And manga and animated arts began at that period during the 15-year-old war. And that's what I would like to focus on tonight. Because if I talk about manga as an animated art, because in this 15-year period, there was a relationship. And there was a relationship between starting in 1931, right up to 45, Japan was a fascist regime. It was a very militaristic regime. And we were under this regime 15 years. It was a continual war during the situation, where the manga aesthetics was forged. It was under this regime that it was first forged. In the Second World War, then again, or this 15-year war, we can find the true origins of otaku as well, And is again, I think this is a way, it's a very relevant way of identifying the origin. If you look at the preamble, I've been along in this my introduction now. Let me go into some concrete details. And I do apologize. And to, now let me get find where I was in my presentation. Okay, again, my conclusion, I was talking about my 15 years in Japan, that 15-year period. And as I already stated, Disney began. Eisenstein also was at that period. Eisenstein, two artists which emerged from that period, they had a way of they had a vision, had their vision began to be well known, and Japanese manga animation at the same time under a fascist regime, where Japan was at war against the United States. There was a different way, of course. It was not a socialist regime. It was not a socialist regime, and it used animated art in a very specific way. And it was very little bit of a strange way of expressing things, but again, it was. This is I have to insist on this beginnings of manga at this time. Let me give some concrete examples. Disney and Eisenstein in Japan, and when I speak about these two key figures. It's perhaps a little bit disconcerting because if we look at the 1920s in Europe, or in Europe, 1920s in Europe, as these countries, the avant-garde futurist movement also affected Japan. The avant-garde movement in Japan during the 1920s, and again, this is one of the Hokusai, was one of the influences. But then in the 20s, in the avant-garde period of history, these were the beginning of the forging influences on manga. And this must be kept in mind. Otherwise, we'll never be able to fully understand what manga means to the Japanese culture. Today, again, Disney and Eisenstein represent a very specific trend. The alliance against nature in between against nature. There, the Russian avant-garde movement and for animated drawings and the whole aesthetic of staging the Russian avant-garde movement with Eisenstein was very closely united had a great deal of influence in Japan. And even it was not strange, therefore, that Eisenstein and Chaplin were associated in Japanese mind. They had a very, very perceived as being. One might have never thought that they would be linked. That would make a link between Chaplin and Eisenstein. So the characters, why? What's the connection between the Russian avant-garde and Disney? Again, as I get towards the end of the 1920s, as in Europe and Japan, there was again the avant-garde monks, Toyoshi Murayama in Japan, began to initiate his work. There was in 1924. His book, which is, as you can see the title here of his book, which was published, led to a certain conservatism in the drawing, in the animated arts. And again, this had a great deal of influence as well. It's not the question that he didn't understand what constructivism was doing, There was the mechanized expression. There was a great deal of fascination with the very mechanistic expression in cinema and in various other media. There was also, they talked of the machine, the fascination of the machine, as the futurists also were, that the machine became the object of a great deal of praise or a great deal of media attention. And when we talk about the constructive expression, and there's a very geometric combination of the characters, using geometric dimensions, and so this was the attempt to understand constructivism, and he then introduced this concept first to Japan. In Japan at that time, how did the Japanese of the time, contemporary Japanese of that time, try to understand this constructivism, fascination with the machine? And you can see in 1925 the figures, the use of the squared figures, round shapes. This is one way of presenting constructivism, the building. And so, again, towards the 1920s, the avant-garde futurist movement in Japan, there were people who were actively involved. This is weird, this one figure of a Japanese, this is a Japanese performance at the time. This was an attempt to this was a type of performance. Michi and Naho, Takanasara, that is involved strange choreographies of this type. For it was called this. They gave performances across the city, or they might throw rocks at prestigious classical museums. This type of this. At any country, this is the type of, we find these things a little bit everywhere across the world at that time. And then as we move towards the 1930s, with Stalin in Russia, began to react the avant-garde, the constructivist artists in Russia, who were active in the Soviet Union. They came under Stalin's repression. So and it gave way to socialist realism. In Russia, avant-garde art gave way to socialist realism. Now, with this type of change, this type of shift towards socialist realism, that there were, not everybody was involved in that. Another example, Michinou Kazuraka, who did the his work on the his Siho Tagawa. The Inorako in 1931 started with this type of animated art. In 1931, the Mashuoko incident gained a lot of notoriety, which is seen as a phenomena in Japan, where Japan was building a country of puppets, or a country of lackeys. And for the and again, Niakulo wrote for 15 years. And Niakulo was referred to in many different ways. There were some who said that it was not exactly accurate, that this was not an accurate way to portray him. But we can say Niakulo was the beginning of the modern tradition in Japan. And what we have to see is this, what appears to be which seems to be print work, or which seems in the history of manga, of Japanese manga, back in the 12th century, we were people doing this who were doing this type of print work. We saw the dog in the last photo. Here we see the rabbit. Is this continued the same tradition? Think of it. Do they continue through the same tradition? For myself, this rabbit, it leads to the mouse. It leads to the mouse. Now, what about the mouse? In 1931, there was an incident, the Manchow in Manchuria, the Manchuria engagement of Japan in Manchuria, and again, American cartoons began to appear after the Manchuria event. And with as the invasion of Manchuria intensified, in the news, there were cinema rooms, cinema shows were specialized to give the news, where people wanted to hear the news in the movie houses. And with the news, they also presented the short runs, the short cartoons. And Mickey Mouse began to appear, of course, it began to appear in the newsreels. After the birth of Mickey Mouse, and again, this was used as in newsreels, and particularly in Japan, And Japan was trying to conquer Manchuria, but was conquered by the Mos. And here's a book here, which I brought over here, from the 1930s, Mickey Mouse. This is a pirate edition. It was a pirate edition in Japan, or an illegal edition. Japanese today say that that these were the Chinese who were launching, who were stealing copyrights. It was only the Chinese that were pirating. But during this period, the Japanese were doing their own amount of pirating for copyright by publishing illegal editions of Mickey Mouse appeared frequently, Felix the Cat, the way that we draw it, our drawings were based on this, with the kind of a Hollywood basis. Japan fully adopted this, began to, and this was what was going on in the 1930s. They were taking American cartoon productions. The first figure, of course, the most famous was Mickey Mouse, and then Miracolo, who became very popular. Miracolo, this is Miracolo, the Japanese figure. You can see the face. You can see the face, the sad face. The hands are round, the round eyes, black. There's a black body. Does this look like Mickey Mouse? Well, for the Japanese, it was very clear. This was the Japanese version of Mickey Mouse. There were a lot of the characters that left. There were a lot of miracle editions or different versions. Calico. If it wasn't Calico, to the right, it's not the same Mickey Mouse. It's not a white Mickey Mouse, but it's a little white bear. It was a little white bear. To the right, Felix, of course. No, it's not Felix the Cat. Professor Nokeshuski. All these characters were imitations of Mickey Mouse and Felix the Cat. So there were Japanese imitations. The Japanese were very, very aware that they were pirating. It was pirate editions. They were fully aware. And what I like about this Mickey Chusiki, another pirate edition, the black mouse is the Japanese mouse, and this series was very jealous of Mickey's popularity, so they tried to disguise himself as Mickey. And then the history of this pirate edition began to have great success. Shiro Tsuki, to the left, the little white bear, the little small teddy bear, as I mentioned earlier, it's not a Mickey Mouse. It was not the mouse. This was, of course, the little white panda, the little white polar bear. But at the beginning of the series, there was a quarrel with the octopus, and the octopus, with his ink, it began with this. He had a confrontation with an octopus, and the black, he's blackened, he's darkened, that's what the editor wanted to show, that he's, again, that Mickey Mouse has been totally he's been transformed into a Mickey Mouse character. And this is how they introduced through his confrontation with the octopus. Then in the Taisho period, Ukuri had the major influence, but the beginning of this was the Showa period, again, the traditions began to end, the Mickey Mouse influence ended at this point. Why? How? Let's look at it from a different perspective now. This is the constructivism, the futurism, paired with the mechanical drawing, combination of geometric figures. Mickey Mouse, again, first point, and let me go back here. How would I say the Mickey Mouse? Assemblage of figures, assemblage of circles. This is he was drawn. At the outset, when we drew a face, the face was the circular figure. We took a coin, just based on a coin. We used the coin, and we made variations on the coin in this way, and we created different faces. It was the way that the composition of circles. That's how the drawings began. That's how they began to actually construct. So again, the influence of constructivism created by the Japanese, they saw Mickey Mouse's figure as a series, again, of geometric figures. This was fully integrated in Japanese culture. Now let me go next step by a minute. Let me get to the right slide here. Siho Tagawa, as I mentioned earlier, who was an avant-garde movement, part of the avant-garde movement, but eventually went towards the manga. He then joined the manga movement. In the artistic history, Michina Tachimisina also joined the manga movement as a popular movement. But Tavaga, on the other hand, was it because was it an evasion? Was he trying to flee from the avant-garde movement? I don't believe so. For example, you look at this figure here, as I mentioned earlier, Siho Tagawa, his very first work that he published was artificial. He worked on a robot. He worked on a work like Lang, like Metropolis, or Chapek, Ruram. He was very familiar with this in the Taisho period. In the 1920s again, avant-garde art for the youth of that time was the robot. The robot was a major motif, was a very symbolic figure. Siho Tagawa, first of all, was influenced by this. He tried to draw his robot. That was the first robot he attempted to create, like Metropolis, the same time Metropolis came out. And after that, let me change my slides here. I can't get there. I can't quite get the one I'm looking for. I don't seem to be able to find it. One slide back, please. I don't seem to be able to get there. But again, you look at the design and drawing here to the right, the mechanical influence of the car, as we saw earlier, as part of the constructivist, the car, the same thing as the, again, as we saw in the constructivist, Tagawa, again, constructivism in 1920. There are many, many examples. The readers in Japan, it seemed almost to be an archaic drawing at that time. But by the 1930s, avant-garde art produced a great deal of drawing, great deal of which were quoted, which were used in this figure. There's a lot of allusions here, but the Japanese did not necessarily understand all the allusions. So Tagawa, to begin his manga drawings, and particularly in this Taisho period, it becomes an extension of the first era that he knew. It becomes the extension. If we cite examples, show examples of the constructivist art, the robot again, the Mickey Mouse from the coin assemblage, and he finally tried to start to imitate Disney, and this was the influence of the Americanism, mechanized animated art. That's they printed, it became a print media as a way for as a mass media communication. The theoreticians of the time, who started from constructivism, saw that manga became an expression of mechanized art, or an expression of mechanized art, and all of this is represented by Tagawa in the Miracolo, again in Miracolo, in the Miracolo series, the Japanese mouse. Don't forget, in the United he was not just involved in theory. Don't forget, in the 1920s, he was throwing stones at the museums. He was not somebody who was only there as a producer, and it was a shift for him. He shifted towards popular culture, and in Japan, we talk about contemporary artists today in Japan when they say that manga is close to Takashima's art. It's a little bit of leaves me with an unpleasant feeling. A little bit of unpleasant feeling because Shigo Tagawa started from the avant-garde movie, and he was the success of the movement. But Takami was not in the same. He went to popular art. He went very much towards popular art. And so I'm not quite at ease by saying that he was. I don't think they understood the manga and its rapprochement with popular art. And perhaps they've not fully understand, or that is contemporary theoreticians. And so when they talk about manga outside of Japan, this perhaps I'm not entirely comfortable with the way it's treated outside the world. So contemporary Japanese artists, when they say that manga reached the whole world, there are also people who are in Japan saying that manga is a representative of our culture. And I'm not entirely at ease with that, saying that it's representative of our culture, the same way as Disney. Disney, from a constructivist perspective, his way of drawing, or Disney's approach of drawing, it was really, really the introduction of this animation in Japan. This is an example of Disney's influence. This is the children's drawings. Again, there is the way of understanding characters. The character is evolving. And again, it's a very constructivist. It's a little bit of a complex concept. For another example, again, these are again examples of constructivism. Even today in Japan, in the 12th century, if we go back to the 12th century, there were people that said that manga began in the 12th century. That it goes back, the story of history was the first book that talks about the history of, in the first books in 1924 was the first book speaking of manga. And again, this is in full constructivist period. And Disney hadn't even yet appeared. It was just prior. This is prior to Disney. And when this book was published in 1934, the book referred to Toba-e in the Kansai region, as Yukio-e, the origin of Yukio-oiwe, and the Yakuga forms, formalism. All this seemed to transform towards manga. And again, and this is when they talk about the history of manga. But when we talk about such exhibits, these manga exhibits, and if we look at Disney in the relationship to the avant-garde movement, I think there's a break. Manga was influenced by Defna after the Second World War, of course, and then more changes began to appear in the 50s and the 1950s. You can see some of the early work in the 1950s. Astro Boy, there were displays, all kinds of posters. There were posters, you see this poster here in this exhibit today. This was the first drawing, Atom, Adam, Django Leo, the Lion King, the original Lion King. In reality, the original of Lion King was Leo. This was Leo, the lion. Both were imitations. Again, the Mickey Mouse here became white. And the ears are more pointed ears, as you can see in the Japanese version. It was in the sought to. So again, this Japanese artist sought to integrate Disney in his work. In the drawing techniques, Disney was very, very visible, which was again the second influence after Russian constructivism, which had been used, which was simple. There had been a simple interpretation of Russian constructivism. And then, but then they began, now for staging, for the staging of animated work. When we talk about the manga in Japan, it's just not the rolls of scrolls of drawings. There was color. Color was used. I don't have the material to show you here, but there was in Daimon, Ikotoba, this was a scroll, drawings on scrolls. Maybe you're familiar that the scrolls were used. Almost like toilet paper, of course, on which we unrolled the paper, only the drawings, with story pictures of illustrations of the history on a toilet paper roll, and you unroll it, and you see the whole, and you can see the pictures. You see the pictures unfold or unroll. The Ghibli studio recognized this technique. Takahata used this technique. He said, that's one way you can look at it. For Takahata, again, we get into the different squares in the squares. Takahata was a genius in animated art, like Miyazaki in the Ghibli studios. He was one of the geniuses, and manga was influenced by him. Was he influenced by manga? Or Ekokudaba at the same time? Engi, as well as the drawings of Engi. This is part of one of the scroll drawing from Engi. At our university, when I show this to my students, these drawings on scrolls, and when I ask them to decompose, picture by picture, this is what they did. This is how they decomposed it. This is my students as well. They're not geniuses like Isatakawa, but naturally, they began to focus in on the focal points. Takawa did it that staging, or the storytelling, the storyboard for manga, it's a little bit like a film, like a staging of a film, the scenario of a film. I don't want you to come to the simplistic conclusion. It's not quite the same way as that we stage a film. It's not because you had scroll drawings that we can, that this is the, which led to the development of manga, but the Japanese did use this technique. And they began to see it in this technique. This was one of the developments. The 15-year war, this was began to, under the fascist regime, they began to use these scroll drawings. And they began to realize that emaki, there were many, many Japanese who began to perceive them this way. And if I talk to my students, one of the examples of this is one of the popular versions. Let me speak about this. The red line, that's the, one of the identification points for the visual contact in the middle, right in the middle. The center line, it's a kind of visual contact. The blue line, on the other hand, if you follow it across the scroll, is the review which travels at a particular point. As the gaze travels, as the gaze moves, when the gaze stops at point by point, or when we change the focus from scene to scene or from point to point, how much time do we stop for? How much time we stop? And that's how we can construct how much time do we stop to focus at each point. And that's what I mentioned a little bit earlier. it's not that difficult to decompose this. Use like a manga is a manga technique, as I mentioned earlier. A building here, a very important building. The gaze stays for a long time in the building, lingers across the building, and then kind of if there's expression on the faces. And with this another major focus point, or the other parts may be smaller, they're of smaller importance. So the gaze travels point by point. And that's how we construct each. And why I'm going into this in detail, I can't go into full detail, but my Japanese students, when I tell them this is an assignment, this is usually how they come back. This is the type of analysis that we'll come up with. Again, following either of the lines, it might focus on one point, it might focus on another point, etc. This is replaced by parts of manga, like a board or they're like the plan in a cinema, like the story plan. Again, staging manga in terms of staging, or how manga is expressed in terms of cinematographic composition, and in a very concrete way, each scene by scene, corresponds to a particular plan in the film, or a shot, a view in the film. There are exceptions, but generally, if we talk about a scene in a movie, in manga, it'll be a single manga. It might be, you can either do this way, it could be worked into the editing. So at the same, we can work at the same level, we can work at both things at the same time. One can be replaced by the shot in the film. In the manga as well, there is this substitution is possible. Either there can be a continuity, an extension of each image by inches. And again, if we look at the drawing on scrolls, again, it's another way of looking at it. Manga is like a film. The expression is similar. The types of expression is very similar. Otomo was not an animated artist, but when he worked on Akira, and when he were to render Hayao Miyazaki, when he tried to do it in an animated way, or nobody was surprised that he used animation. Mangas were able to do animations. They were going to animate Mars, and animators were able to do manga. Manga could do animated art, and vice versa. Otomo did a film. He created a film, and when he became a filmmaker, he became a film director. I wasn't surprised. He went from manga art to becoming a film director, because many Japanese people think that people from manga make an easy transition to cinema as film directors. But a film director cannot do manga, not necessarily. Only manga, it's only one directional, and they can do, or animated art. In manga, there's a basis. There's a kind of a cinematographic base. Misery Productions, in the Tokiyasu group, Fujio School, they did a great, they started as animated studios. Now, let me come back to my subject as earlier. During the 15-year war, again, the drawn scroll, can be seen as sections of manga, and this is because of the Eisenstein. Again, this influence of Eisenstein. This was in 1932. His book was translated, was published in Japan. This was a series of Eisenstein publications devoted to in the 1930s, the Potemkin, the there was had a great deal of influence. There were many translations, a lot of translations. Not all of his work was very. There were dozens of publications of his, and there were more than 15 movie reviews began to appear. A lot of, and Eisenstein was very popular. He was widely published. His theories were widely known and were very popular. And Kinaza was a film director, and his movie went. It was set when you see one of the shots, they're in the public, in the audience. He said, editing, and he said, all of this created that maintaining that he was doing it in the right way. Everybody said it was people. The ordinary people were critics in the room and saying this has all been. And when they saw to the edit scene, the editing, when somebody said this is edited right from the audience, everybody were polite and they sat back down. And it was at this point there was even the public began to recognize this influence. And this is in the 1930s. And this was the influence at the time. There's only a few film magazines today in Japan, but there were more than 100 in the 1930s. There was all kinds of learned journals and magazines on cinema. We talk about the cinema theory. It was a very important area. Or were you talking about new ideology? It was not just the young people, but the general public. The whole public was fascinated with the new role of cinema. And you have to understand how the fascination with cinema in the 1930s. And in the 1930s, the socialism was oppressed. It was totally oppressed. It was not supported. But the theory of Eisenstein, on the other hand, was embraced, which is interesting to know that Eisenstein's film, one single film, was shown in Japan. Only one. How would I say this in English? Frank? Old and new? But Eisenstein? Potemkin, Battleship Potemkin? It was never shown. The Japanese didn't have the opportunity to see the Battleship Potemkin. It was never seen in Japan. They didn't see any of his other major films, but his theories were embraced. His theories, and when Mickey Mouse was presented, those were two of the influences. Eisenstein and Mickey Mouse were both embraced at the same time. So for animated drawings for a country at war, and then the theories from Russia were both embraced at the same time. So it was turning towards Russia and the turning towards Dism. The Japanese, again, didn't seem Potemkin, but the theory of editing, the new theory of editing, they tried to apply this everywhere, across. They tried to apply it everywhere. Let me try to get my slides straight again here. Here, for example, in this poem, this is a poesy. Editing, poems are created through editing. We use editing. A line from a poetry corresponds to one shot in the film. Every verse in the poem corresponds to a different shot, a different film shot. And if you think of that, in the history of cinema, Kinawasa, Desamoniga, and a full page a full page would be could be composed this way. Novels, we can do this in novels, we can look at photos. There's other ways we can express other types of expression which were used with the editing. In other words, novels are written with the eye to use it scene by scene, shot by shot, and to try to both in the in novels, also cinematographic photos, and all of these were used and experimented with in Japan, in Japanese writing. Began to be understood as editing because of Eisenstein. Again, he, as he said, that the characteristic, the main, are the principles of the composition. We use composition. Even the right arm, the one of the legs, even the neck, you adjust the face. Each one can be used in a shot. You can focus on one arm, or you can do it picture by picture. And the I'm not an actor, so I can't really give you an example. I won't give you an example of what. But if I move like this, or if I move my arm, then my leg moves out, and then my face is shown. Three different shots, three movements. It can be used in three different, can be edited. Cover key here. Again, this means the is this all. This is also editing. You have the left hand side. This the skudi. The skudi is the figure. In the kanji, this o, water. This means the eyes. Water, eyes together, because it's the soul. The water and the eyes become the soul. It's a composition. It's a work of composition from the calligraphy, the from the ideogram. There are many cases where this composition, the work of composition, works. As Eisenstein said that, we talk about avant-garde movement, folklore, the primitive art, the art of movement. They saw this as, again, the construction or the composition in African culture. Eisenstein referred to African culture. He found examples of this composition, works of composition. And Japanese, in his very writing, is considered as a primitive culture. Maybe he saw Japan as a primitive culture because we use composition in our writing. When Japan was praised, when it began to be recognized, we're very happy to be mentioned, to be recognized again, recognition as a, but as a work of composition. Tahiti, there's a cinema critic, movie critic, said that Kojiki, we talked about he. This was everything was written. Even our chronicles, our historical chronicles, were works of composition. This type of argument, if we look at the old scrolls of drawings, all this was included in the new theories. There were the artists and the critics of cinema who began to say this. But as we saw earlier in the scroll, in the scroll of drawings, there was no upshot or no other specific shots, which, as I referred to earlier, the scroll is can be seen maybe as the subjectivity, the subjective view of the person, of the viewer. From the this type of way of consider of viewing this, which this had been influenced very much by of the intellectual class of the time in Japan. When this was seen in this way, it was because of Eisenstein, of the influence of Eisenstein. So everything began to be viewed from this lens, from as a composition or editing. And this is Eisenstein again, Eisenstein's in works of what this is the delegation of painting. In Japan, when the tree, when we paint a tree, you break it down, you decompose it first, section by section, and we work morsel by morsel. And this is what we try to teach, how to make a proper drawing. Again, it's a composition, or and if we look at it, school, again, like the school, the Japanese will look at this as a montage. As I said, it's a montage. What Eisenstein stated, Shivisangengi as well. We can apply this to Shivisangengi, the Japanese from that time. This is acceptable to look at it this way, as montage. And the Russian avant-garde, then Eisenstein, the time when these people were, they were Marxists, of course. The Russian avant-garde was very much influenced by Marxism. And Japan, I forgot them, leave the Marxism aside, but we'll take, they didn't ask them to forget their aesthetic theory or Eisenstein's theory of a montage and composition. That's why there are still people who have the Thomas to begin to more and more and begin the tiger. This is montage. This is a montage in the Graf montage. It's a propaganda magazine from the Union of Soviet. This was called to be propaganda. The combination of photos, there were two different pages we're looking to. It tells a story. There's a story being told. The collage of pictures, of collage of photos, a little bit like a manga. It's called a montage. It was a montage. It was, there were sections from manga were presented in this way. And we can, you can see again. Look at the, see the origins of manga. Yes, again, applied montage or Imola Mara, who thought we could find the origin of montage in the scroll. In the scroll again first. Then this book was the theory of cinema of manga by Imola. It was the first critic of animated art. He's presented as the first critic of animated art. Or his studio, the studio, which he had, which Takawa had a lot of influence, had a lot. Taihi Imumura, in his book was the original was in 1941. Then it, in 1941, then it, there's the theoretic. The cinematographic theory of manga, first published in 1941, there was the cover page. The first page, open the first page, the Mickey Mouse appears right on the, as you might have expected. When the war broke up with the Americans, American culture was oppressed. No English was permitted. All the cultural elements from the United States were forbidden, which were. However, the Imla Mla theory, even after the war began with the Americans, his book was published, and you can see the icon here. And to understand how he did this, this had a strange destiny of manga from this time. Omulai then published a second book, which was a theory. The cinematographic theory of documentary cinema, theory of documentary cinema. Again, we're in the 15-year war, again. As the war unfolded and as the war progressed one way or the other, there was the news as were presented in the movie houses. The newsreels were presented in the movie house. Children didn't want to see the noise, so they use Mickey Mouse, Felix the Cat as distractions, had to be presented so that people could hear the news. At that time, the critic was a young leftist, influenced by Marxism. He was involved in the communist movement. He was arrested, so he had to abandon communism. But then he went into the movie business, and he created two genres, the documentaries and animated films. Taihei Momura, therefore, made documentaries and then in animated art. There was no any critics. There were no critics of these two fields, either of documentaries or animated art. So he launched himself into both these fields. He said that he would work on them to become, as a critic, he would work as a critic of documentaries and a critic of animated art. Imamura, as I mentioned earlier, again, Eisenstein and Disney's were influences. provided an alliance against nature. He was involved in this. He tried to support, in a theoretical way, as we might say. When the Pacific War broke, when the Pacific Front woke up, the naval forces tried to support animated films. They tried to use animated film to, so it was the Navy that supported animated film. Why the Navy? The Japanese Navy sought to support this art form, or Taihei Imamura said, he has said something about this. What his comment on this was, which, and I find the quote from his quote, the Pacific War is a film, he wrote. Imamura said, Disney animation, the excellence in his animation is because it becomes an arm of publicity and a weapon of publicity which has a role to play, a very important role to play. For publicity, and if we didn't have animated art, animated drawing, the other countries will demonstrate our weakness. They will say weakness. It becomes an arm. It became an arm. If we don't have a Disney in Japan, it'll be a sign of weakness. It means we will have failed the war. We will have lost the war. So the Navy was under threat. The Navy was under, and they accepted, therefore, to use animation as a sign of their strength. The army, the Navy was certainly at war that in any city, the Disney animations were present. Disney was always present. And the army was also aware. The land forces began to realize the strength of Disney as well, the importance of Disney. And they thought, if we don't get our own Disney, we will lose. And the Navy was the first, therefore, to accept that this theory, or therefore, they perhaps didn't use it correctly. They didn't make very good animation, but this Imamura, who was the critic, seems to, I think maybe he was a typical fascist, but he convinced the Navy to use animation. For him, the emperor and the Japan were not important really for him. What was important for him was Disney animation and Eisenstein. That's were important. Taihei Imamura, throughout the whole war, told the army, if we don't get our Disney, we're going to lose the war. And that was his whole continual threat. There were different critics, there were different writers who tried to collaborate as well. Hishi Odogama tried to collaborate in literature, in Japanese literature. He tried to support his convictions. But not with manga. Not manga. He created the scenario for manga because influenced by the Minister of Interior in Japan. He tried to write in a way that should be acceptable to the Japanese government. All his writing was, and Taike Imamura, in the same way as the Japanese writers for animated film, was totally involved in the Japanese war effort. So animated art as an arm, as a weapon. Again, if we don't get our Disney, we'll lose. In Disney aesthetics, he therefore helped to create the propitious environment that Disney for it to be fully integrated in the Japanese culture. These were different animated films presented by the Navy, by the Japanese Navy. There's a few scenes. What do this? And I'll show you a few shots.
Momotaro,
the divine soldier of the sea, the divine sailor. There were a lot of studies on this. So this work he wrote, the divine sailor, member of the naval forces. And let me check this with you. Outside of Japan, Disney. How was Disney accepted? I don't know how Disney helped outside of in other countries. Germany, Hitler, for example. Hitler's attitudes were forbade Disney. But it was imported. Stalin also forbade. There was on the collective farms. There were collective farms in the Soviet Russia, in Stalinist Russia, and the way that they produced Disney. He ordered that the Disney would be applied to the collective farm movement. The Disney aesthetics would be used to promote collective farms. But neither Goebbels nor Stalin tried to introduce it. They didn't. Only in Japan did. They really use a lot of propaganda in behalf of Disney in Japan. Neither Goebbels nor Stalin promoted Disney in their respective countries. That's why animated film continued in Japan. Animated artists or animated filmmakers didn't all see Eisenstein. Not all of them saw Eisenstein. Of the time, the theory of montage, Eisenstein's theory of montage, and similar theories, Leffenstiel was inspired. Lenny movies were presented, many were presented at the different film festivals. He saw a Lenny film, and he wrote this presented in this way. Depples as well. Lang asked to shoot a film on Hitler. Goebbels asked Lang to film Hitler. Goebbels said he admired. And then Lenin came. In the place, the Leffenstiel, looking at Eisenstein's films, led the Japanese people try to understand what was the theory behind their way of their view of the world, their worldview. Some films were presented from Germany, which also reflected this. There was German influence in Germany. I won't go into that because I don't. It's not my theme today. I won't go into German influence. But again, the theory of Eisenstein. They tried to create. Again, during the 15-year war, again, the major influences, Motoroto, the divine sailor, was the first long feature animated film. But there's no star, there's no far. It was kind of glorifying, it was a documentary film of glorifying sailors, glorifying the Navy, parachute, the paratroopers. There's a military operation which takes place. It was presented and reproduced. Thanks to this, as a film, they shot films of the naval operations. Again, an animated documentary. It was called a cultural film. It was referred to as a cultural film. Again, this, as again, it was, in other words, the divine sailor, was again presented as a work of culture. Using Disney methods. Using the Eisenstein theory of montage, these were the fundamental aspects of the film, of this behind the divine soldier of the sea. This is the scene. You can see the scenes from the long feature animated film. This is the parachute, the paratrooper, the parachute. This is, again, propaganda. These works of propaganda. This is this was illustrators of a paratrooper. Lefranc was a review. It was shown in that. Yanni Gida was the editor of this magazine. And again, used this for, this was for the, for abroad propaganda. Used abroad. After the Second World War, the Frank magazine, and in this review, as in the same, the long feature animated film, there was military operations, and they looked at paratroopers, they looked at the, again, this long feature, if we look at the divine sailor, the divine soldier of the sea, there's realism in it. I would like to show you some other pictures if I have the time, but this is the rabbit again. The rabbit is the character, but there's a lot of realism. He's behind an arm. He's using his he's and again here we can say Disney would make it all of a cartoon. It would be always simplistic from Disney, but in the Japanese animated film, mixture of realism. The arm is very realistic. The character is an extension of Mickey Mouse, so it's a combination of two of them. Another characteristic, the low angle and the upshot. The avant-garde movement, of course, from Rotochenko, which you can see in his works, the same angle from the shot. In the Potemkin, Battleship Potemkin, use this frequency, this low shot angle. Lenny Leffenstiel, in her work, looked at the unknown soldier, and the general public were shown with this type of shot. These again, in Eisenstein and Lenny, these were this, and look at the same thing. They're looking now at the Japanese character. It's the same shot, the same view, but it's a cartoon character. Here's the sharp angle. It is an elevated angle. The culminating point is very, very sharp. It's a very sharp composition. Rotochenko, that's a Rotochenko picture. This is a scene from Eisenstein in the sea, a shot at sea. They're very, very sharp angles. And for animated artists, they borrowed exactly directly from this. You can see here, from the Divine Sailor of the Sea, typical composition. You can see the object, and in the background, smaller versions of the same object, which are then drawn. Here, the same thing. You can see, you see the major shot, the close up. They're bigger pieces, parts. And you can see the characters, the countryside, clouds. This is the part of the elephant. You can see the elephant with his trunk, and then there's successive elephants in the background. So they're successive layers. This is a method of the multiply theory. But images created in this way, the multiplan shot. This type of multiplan shot was a reference. Eisenstein, the same thing. There were the figures, the characters who are drawn in the close up in the background. This is a typical characteristic of Eisenstein composition. Close up and background. In the background, another shot. In Japan, Japanese animated artist Takahata liked this type of composition. The close up shot, the personage, and then successive characters were drawn at different points, different layers of GAN, different plans. This is the multi-plan technique. in the multi-shot, but it's a reproduction of a typical Eisenstein composition. If I had more time, we could go into this in greater detail. But animated art is not making something moving. It's not to make something move. It's not really the real. It's not the camera work. It's the camera which tries to get closer. The camera tries to get closer. The plane is seen first in the close-up shot. Then afterwards, the camera begins to look at different. There was movements of the camera positions, the shift in the camera position. It's not the, it says that person who moves, it's the camera that moves. It's the camera work, which was very evident in animated art, in animated film. And this, on the one, it's animated art, and at the same time, it's a documentary. Again, the plane is a symbol. It was drawn in a very realistic way, very realistic drawing. And from here, perhaps the major fair characteristic is that there's a lot of different shots or a lot of different plans. So again, the composition of a lot of different shots. And the continuity of the scenes, which gives you one unified scene. It was in the Divine Sailor of the Sea again. There's a full animation. These are, I think, some of the characteristics of this major feature film documentary. There's this scene, the opening scene, and I present the opening scene because this has recently been discovered. This is part of his notes. After the day of the victory, these notes, these parts which were not discovered until victory, just before the end of the war in 1945. He wrote this book just before 1945. And only part of it was recently discovered. The rabbits here again, like this, a little bit like a Disney style, who does aircraft maintenance, the same shot was presented in the Divine Soldier of the Sea, the Divine Sailor, the first scene, the opening scene. And what is Osamu Tezuka and Motorata in the Divine Soldier, he wrote, until the victory, this is up to the day of victory, to the day of victory, that was the title. It was not a commercial reason, it was not a commercial purpose, but he was young, Tezuka was young. These were in his notes, he put this in his notebooks to show to his friends, and to his brothers, to his sisters, to his colleagues. He was a teenager. And what he wrote at the time, there was a work until the day of victory. It was a little bit of a strange work because Tezuka, in his diary or in his notes, he wrote, that's what he wrote. But there's other mangas, there's own stories. But this, to the day of victory, which again, it was a cultural film. It was a documentary without a story, as I mentioned. There's no story in it. There's no Osamu Tezuka. Saw the Divine Soldier of the Sea. There's no documentation to confirm this, but recently this notes were discovered, and Tezuka, who wrote at the time, until the day of victory, and it's now been proven that he saw the documentary, he saw the divine. Why is this proof that he saw the feature? Because Tezuka's method, there are different theories that are often quoted. Some people said that Tezuka tried to invent all his works from scratch, from nothing, that everything was invented, that he was the author of manga, everything became a tezuka, that everything started with. It was the beginning of the manga creative work. However, during the 15-year war, he was a young man. There were prototypes which he had access to, which we see at the same period. So the cinema method, or the cinematographic method, was applied in Tezuka's work. Again, think of the work of the Divine Soldier of the Sea, which was a major influence. This illustrated documentary, the planes coming closer, the shot from below, the same angle. You can. These are examples that from till the day of victory. This was in his notebooks when he was a university student, and it's interesting to see the influence. As I mentioned earlier, there's no story in the animated film that we're talking about an air attack, an air raid, series of air raids seen by Japan. It's an illustration of what the Japanese experienced, a Japanese character, a Disney type of figure, type of character. The way that's drawn, the person, like a Disney character, is very similar. In this manga, there's a Mickey Mouse. Starting from Miracolo in the 30s, starting with Miracolo, were there. The characters were there. They were under the influence of Disney during the Second World War. Disney was used as propaganda in the Japanese forces. So Tezuka was aware that Disney was a figure for propaganda in Japan, and this was known in the cinemas and the original movie reels, So the American characters and the Japanese characters were very similar and drawn, and so Tezuka was influenced, and this is, I think, what we can. The manga was used as propaganda. It's not because he was asked to draw for it, only because he was exposed to it. He didn't. But it shows to what impact this long feature film had, The Divine Sailor of the Sea. In his notes, he wrote, "This animated work has expressed in a definitive way that it was a cultural war. There's a cultural film. It was a cultural film." He said it's a cultural and artistic work, as he noted in his diary at the time. He saw that it was a cultural film from the time, and when he saw it as a cultural work. And he tried to do the same thing when he began to draw the manga in his own notebook. He made his own manga. There's a type of process which you can see, you can reconstitute until the day of the victory. These were his notes. These important sequences that he drew, young man, there's the young boy, there's the military airplane, the flight, the escape, Mickey Mouse, who's the pilot, and then he flees, then he becomes, he holds the three lines indicating blood, there's the blood is hit. This is the culminating point of his work, in his notes. Disney style for the characters, the realistic plane, is realistic, composition, cinema composition. Sometimes we exaggerate his contribution to Tezuka, but Hitchcock himself, there's the scene in Hitchcock where the hero is chased away, is being chased, 16-year-old boy, who began to draw this way. He doesn't have any cinema background at this point, but he's drawing. Again, I talked about the Divine Sailor of the Sea. It's not the only thing he saw. He saw this as well, but he began to draw and take this into account of other similar works. to that it would be possible to express his own work in a new way. He was precocious. He was a predecessor. Again, the characters from Disney, the composition from Eisenstein, in all of his manga, he added new elements, of course, here, for example. In the Divine Sword of the Sea, there's one part of this where the part of the sandwich was cut. It was censored. Part was censored. The soldier or animals which are wounded or which were wounded were censored, as you know, because they were like Mickey Mouse. Is not mortal. Even if he's hit, he comes back. So there was never a question of, and he's never seriously wounded, never mortally wounded, even if he's shot at many, many times. But he's never hit. So this Mickey Mouse style, but here, his character is killed, because just prior to that, Osamu Tezuka lived in Osaka. Tezuka lived in Osaka. There were a lot of air raids, major air raids. The Japanese lost control of the air, and Osaka was targeted by major air raids. With small fighter jets, even non-combatants were attacked and were shot at with the machine gun. This is Tezuka experienced these types of air raids towards the end of the war. So he was a young man, who lived through the war. And these three elements provided him with an idea for this, whose only choice was express himself in this way. He was given a manner of expression. He gave him a real person in flesh and blood. This Mickey Mouse, that's the emperor. As I mentioned earlier, and like Bambi, who's then replaced by the Lion King. In the jungle, there were even scenes for Tezuka, Osamu Tezuka. It was evident that the Mickey Mouse, as Leo the Lion, and then he becomes mortal. For Tezuka, he gave him a living body, a real thing. He can have a. But he can die as well. Starting from the birth to death, which he lent to one of the Disney characters, he becomes mortal. On the contrary, the Disney characters. And in this very long story, he created a genre, manga, with a story. And I think I'm out of time. I can't go into details. His presence in the history of manga in Japan has a capital importance, because his cinema methods were applied to the manga work. What he wrote until the Day of Victory in his notes, in his young university notes. You can see the beginnings of his work as its influence of the Divine Sword of the Sun by Eisenstein and by Disney. Both were united in the same picture. Tezuka, as a human being who lived through the 50-year war, in terms of the theory of cinema, he fully understood of all the cinematographic currents and trends. And what he learned and what he used in his explanations of his manga. Again, there are many terms from cinema, many terms from Eiji's cinema. Tezuka was very much under the influence of Eisenstein, and he drew his manga works. And you can see there's many, many of his examples. And Tezuka, who was a teenager during the time of the wine, and under the influence again, the two major influences led to the beginning. Eisenstein Tezuka led to the beginning of the Tokusatsu group, the visual. He was behind the many, many groups in the Jumbla studios. And other groups who created mangas, who created other types of manga expressions. They're a little bit further away in their drawings from Disney. They distance themselves from Disney. Art Deco, they were influenced by Art Deco and Art Nouveau for the manga. Art Deco, they modified Art Deco in a way. I can't go into that anyway. Manga for girls. This is, if we talk about extension of manga, of Tezuka's manga, this is one of the extensions that we have to review, we have to look at that. And again, the influence of Mickey Mouse is always present in his work. But this character, Tezuka gave him as a living creature, and flesh and blood, a flesh and blood creature. Therefore, young people, or you, young people, or the young creators, have tried to give him to sexual activities, because he's got a flesh and blood body. He's a real character, so are the themes which are related life and to death. As again, during the 15-year war in Japan, Disney and Eisenstein were both united in a strange form of expression. And I think this could be studied more deeply. I hope I've abbreviated my own researches, but I hope I've explained to you some of the beginning of the history of manga in Japan. It was not ukiyo-e, it was not postmodernism, it's not otaka who began. All avant-garde art began where both Eisenstein and Disney had influence in the whole world, even in a small island in the Orient, in the Pacific. Curiously, the two worlds met. This is the theme that I wanted to present to you. I will stop at this point. And thank you for having listened to me attentively.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Otsuka. We have obviously a little time. We're a little running over here. We can have time for a couple of questions. There are two mics set up over here, so please go ahead and ask questions. Any questions? No? Yes, okay.
Do I keep my headset on?
You just speak into the mic.
Do I keep the headset on after?
Yes, you will need to hear the answer. Okay.
Hey, Professor Otsuka, very, very interesting talk. I actually had a question concerning Japanese manga versus Disney and Einstein, trying to see if they actually offset one another or they influence one another. And what I also wanted to know is that, are the Americans using psychological warfare against the Japanese when you're talking about Manchurian takeover on a larger scale? or did the Japanese end up winning that on the anime side, since they're the one taking over today? Yeah, the first or second one? Both?
Both.
Okay, sorry about that. So what I said is, do you think that Japanese manga versus Disney and Einstein offset one another? Or if they influence one another? That's the first part of it. And the second one is that when we're talking about Manchuria, the takeover by the Japanese on physical side of things, realistically speaking, and how the Americans were using psychological warfare to try and destabilize Japan. Basically, at the end of the day, who ended up winning the battle, since the Japanese are actually the one still on top in terms of in the virtual world, although the Americans actually took it on the realistic side of things. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, thanks a lot.
Disney, the simple influence of Disney in terms of this, Disney is of course, a lot of his, after his death, Disney's increased. Disney's, Disney and Tezuka, there was no relationship. There was no direct relationship between Disney and Tezuka. The Japanese in general accepted Disney. It was a little bit as in Canada. You have Japanese restaurants in Canada. You have sushi in Canada. What you see in Canada, the sushi you have in Canada, it's not the same as sushi in Japan. That's so the Japanese, the Tezuka. That's the Tezuka appears to be a version of Disney's work.
Do you have a question you'd like to ask?
Yes, I do. With regards to Einstein's and Walt Disney's influence on manga as a propaganda tool, did it contribute to the current form of anime as we currently see it today?
Thank you.
Well, Mamoru, the Divine Sword of the Sea, the style that he used in that, this was followed by the Ghibli Studio. This was taken up by the Ghibli Studio. And the real military jets were used in animated films. Kynex and Evangelion as well. We used the same realistic drawings. Self-defense, again. There's work which is presented with realism, using realism. The Divine Sailor of the Sea, again, Motomoro, was the departure, point of departure for his Japanese animated films.
I would ask this question in Japanese, but I don't want to embarrass myself. So I'm interested in the status of these animation techniques, you know, particularly the montage technique, and basically how these techniques were employed in other parts of the colonial empire. I'm referring here specifically to Manchukuo, and you know that particular place had a very well-developed cinema industry. And I'm wondering if these techniques wind up in, say, propaganda in Manchukuo and just in other parts of the colonial empire. Thank you.
For the montage techniques, during the 15-year war, there were documentary films, of course, we made which use the montage. There were many, many documentaries made, not just The Divine Soldier, which is animated. Also in documentary film, there is montage. There were different movie makers or directors, several directors who converted from Marxism, the locomotive, for example, by using the montage effect to draw locomotives as the train, for example.
It seemed that in the first place, anime and manga was something for the average person, and something, you know, universal or something that any person in society could read, and it carried messages across. It was its own medium that a lot of people used to carry messages across to different people. And over time, it became centered around otaku, and it became hermetic again. What do you think of this one? What do you think? What is your Sorry, one second.
You could speak in French too.
Why did you get into making manga, and especially what was your message and especially with MPD Psycho, what was your message in that? And what inspired you to get into it and make it yourself?
Thank you.
In answer to your first question, Japanese manga, otaku, there was a limited market. At first, there was a limited market for the. So there's been a dwindling market, if you want. So it's a limited. It's a limited theme. Otaka as a limited theme, has become. It's the self-culture, it's starting to lose its interest. For my work, the message of my work, it'd be a long answer if I have to answer you what my message is. I talked about this with an American at one point. There are characters. Are multiple, some multiple characters, multiple personalities, like an onion. If you take one layer off after the other, you take one layer off the onion as you go. Other characters appear. There's this nucleus of the onion at one point. Is that how I did my work? I asked, this is the question he asked. The American asked me this question. I said, no, that's not how I work. I said, if I took a monkey, if he starts to take off the layer of the onion, nothing's left. There's nothing left. Is that right? Is that right? And I said, I don't know if it's right, if it's the right way to
produce. Maybe time for one more question.
Sure. First of all, Professor Otsuka, I really enjoyed the talk, obviously. Hope everybody else did. I have to admit, my question is actually pretty selfish, and it's less a question than I kind of want an elaboration. You mentioned, and I found it really interesting, that the conceptualization of a manga is similar to a film. And I took you to mean in kind of like the visual tableau aspect, the way it's actually constructed. I'm wondering if you can elaborate on that a little bit more, maybe cite some examples. And again, I confess, I might have kind of misunderstood what was being said at that point.
And examples of the Yamashima, there's a director, a film director, Namisha Oshima, Ninja Brigade Show, the Ninja Brigade Show, when he made this film with the title, the Ninja Brigade Show. He borrowed the scenario, and he borrowed the scenario, and he tried to bring his camera. He tried to create a film. After that, he said, "This is a film," and he made a film from his manga. This is one example that I can quote for you.
Hello. I hope you got your answer. Alors, voulez m'accompagner de remercier non seulement professeur Otsuka, mais notre traductrice Akane d'Orangeville et mes collègues Mark Steinberg et Matt Penny pour cette présentation, cet événement cet après-midi. Et au même temps, je voudrais remercier encore une fois la Grande Bibliothèque pour le chaleureux accueil qu'ils nous ont fourni cet après-midi. Et enfin, je dois vous rappeler qu'il y aura une colloque demain, qui commence à 10 heures, au cinéma de Sèvres, à l'Université Concordia, où plusieurs spécialistes québécois, québécoises et d'étrangers discutent les médias japonais. Et même à la fin de la journée, ça commence à 4 heures, à 16 heures demain, le jeu Mixcade aura lieu à l'édifice EV, c'est au coin de la rue Guy et Sainte-Catherine, où vous pouvez pratiquer des jeux animés qui viennent de l'Université Concordia et plusieurs d'autres origines. Alors, merci encore une fois cet après-midi d'être venu et à la prochaine.